mirror appropriately. Not only mirror is required, the mirror should be appropriately used. Then Shastra Pramanam will give me knowledge. And how should I use the mirror? What is the operation of Shastra Pramanam? That alone we discuss in the fourth chapter. Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya upadekshanti te jnanam jnaninas tattvadarshinaha. You have to go through twofold exercises known as shravanam and mananam. Shastra shravana mananam is the exercise called jnana yoga, called Vedanta Vichara, called Adhyatma Yoga, called Brahma Jignasa. These are different words. And what is the definition of Shravanam? The definition of Shravanam is systematic and consistent study of the scriptures for a length of time under the guidance of a competent acharya. Systematic and consistent study of scriptures dealing with the self, not any other scripture. Scriptures dealing with the self for a length of time. Oru naalaki ketten, ara naalaki ketten illa solla kudadhu. For a length of time, under the guidance of a competent acharya is called shravanam. And when this is done appropriately, shravanam produces self-knowledge. You have to operate this and see for yourself. Kannadiya paathunda unga kanna paakalam. Sandeham irunda enna panna? Suppose I have got doubt, what should I do? Suppose I have got doubt, what should I do? I should use the mirror and see for myself whether I can see my eyes. Similarly, use the Vedanta Shravana and see for yourself whether self-knowledge arises or not. It will arise. So thus, Shravanam produces knowledge. And when, as even I listen to the scriptures, certainly I will receive the knowledge also, but parallelly, doubts also arise in the mind. Not only it produces knowledge, but parallelly it produces doubt. Is it true? Because Vedantic teaching is so different from what we know that it is unbelievable. Because whatever I am seeking in life, Vedanta says, I already am. I am seeking fullness, Vedanta says, you are full. I am seeking peace, Vedanta says, you are peace. I am seeking security, Vedanta says, you are secure. I am seeking the truth. That is the greatest thing. I am seeking the truth. Vedanta says, you are the truth. In fact, you alone are the truth. Aduvare. The seer is the truth. The seen is untruth. Anyway, I don't want to go into that. That is the teaching. And therefore, naturally the mind puts umpteen question, how can I be ever secure? How can I be truth? So, umpteen questions come, and the instruction is that don't ask the questions immediately. Comprehensively listen to the teaching and receive all the important features of the teaching. Receive all the important features of the teaching, and until you complete that, keep your doubts aside. Apdi vechukom. You can write down, Swamiji makes this statement, I don't accept. You can put maximum, if you feel bad, you can put a comma and say, with due respects to Swamiji. Respect does not mean you should accept whatever I say. You can respectfully disagree with me. And the teacher will encourage. Teacher will say, Sabhash. Because teacher is at least sure that he is listening. No, because to disagree, you should listen. Because listening is the most difficult task in the world. Listening is the most difficult task in the world. And I get the knowledge, but the knowledge is weakened by parallel doubts. The fundamental doubt being, why I should accept the scriptures? Adhuve basic doubt. From that onwards, all possible questions under the sun, you can imagine. And this knowledge is called samshaya sahita jnanam. Knowledge, but mixed with doubts. It is like pepper and kalkand. Kalkand sweet irukku, pakkathula pepper irukku. And a doubtful knowledge is not knowledge. Doubtful knowledge is, for all practical purposes, ignorance only. Suppose a wire is hanging here, a cable, and you want to touch that wire. You ask me, is there power? Is that wire live wire? I said, no, it is not a live wire you can touch. Then when the other person is about to touch, I say, 99% I am sure, but 1% there is a possibility. Will you touch? You will get immediate liberation. Swami Chinmayananda says, spiritocution, you know, electrocution like. So even if 1% doubt is there, that 90% knowledge possibility is useless. Not even 1.0001% is there, it is not knowledge. And therefore, the spiritual sadhana continues. The second stage of spiritual sadhana is in the removal of doubts. In the first stage, I am gathering the teaching. And whatever doubts come, I keep aside. And the second stage of sadhana is exclusively meant to remove all possible doubts, which is called samshaya nivritti, otherwise called mananam. And when I go through this mananam, I ask questions to myself, and then with the data, the teaching that I have received, I myself try to answer my question. In fact, generally, I will be able to do that. That's why they say, Acharyat padamadatte padam shishyasvamedhaya. The teacher cannot say everything. So you learn 1/4 from the teacher, and the other 1/4 you have to churn yourself, reflect on the teaching, and you will find the teaching is capable of removing the doubt. Only you have to rearrange the teaching, then that answer is there. Only present it differently. And if you are not able to solve by yourself, you can ask the co-students, Padam sa brahmacharibhyaha. Because what perspective you don't have, the other student may have. Therefore, in the discussion, it will go away. It will go away means not knowledge, doubt will go away. Okay. Doubt will go away. And if that also doesn't solve, Guru is there. And we have got so many books in Vedanta which raises all the possible questions belonging to the past, belonging to the present. Even future possible questions are envisaged in our scriptures and answered. Nee naalaku enna kelvi kekkayo adhe ipo solli vechudren. We have got thousands of books answering all possible questions. And this process of mananam will convert the knowledge into conviction, which is called dridha jnanam, which is called nissamshaya jnanam, which has to be gained not through meditation, but only through shravana mananam. You have to use your intellect, because knowledge is the job of the intellect. Knowledge is the job of the intellect. That is why the Upanishads very clearly say, manasai vedam aptavyam. Through the intellect alone, you have to gain the knowledge. Body cannot get knowledge. Atma, the self, cannot get any knowledge. Knowledge has to take place only in one locus, and that locus is the intellect alone. Who say? The Upanishads point out. Manasai vedamaptavyam. Katha Upanishads. In Mundaka Upanishad, Yesho nuratma chetasa veditavyaha. So this atma has to be known through the chetaha. Chetas means what? Intellect. And again elsewhere in Kathopanishad, drishyate tvagriyaya buddhya sukshmaya sukshmadarshibihi agriyaya sukshmaya buddhya drishyate. Only with the help of the intellect, any knowledge has to be gained, including the spiritual knowledge. And intellect knows only one language. And what is that? A reasoning. Therefore, you have to reason it out, remove all doubts, and convert it into a conviction. And what is the conviction? I am the truth of this creation. I am the substratum of this creation. I have no doubt about that. Whether the other people have doubt or not, I don't care. But for my knowledge to bless me, I should be convinced. Otherwise, it will be like that story Swami Chinmayananda tells, that a person had a feeling that he is a worm. You know, Puru? Somehow he had a psychological fixation that I am a worm, Nakapuchi or Puru or whatever it might be. And therefore, he had to be treated in a mental hospital, and the therapist has to bring him, and he had to bring a mirror in front, and take a worm also, and ask him to see who you are. Are you like this worm? And he said, now it is very clear, I am not a worm. Now, when he was thinking that I am a worm, he was always afraid of birds, because worm means birds will eat up. And therefore, he had a mortal fear of birds. And therefore, the doctor had to temporarily put him in a place where birds are not there, because birds are kandale, will be out. Therefore, keeping the birds aside, he had to be taught, you are not a worm, you are a human being. You are not a worm, you are a human being. Shravanam, all those things he did. And then the doctor asked, are you sure? He said, yes, I am very sure. Who are you? I am a human being, not a worm. And then the doctor was very happy. He said, now you are discharged, you can go back. And he came out and saw the first bird. And the moment he saw the bird, again he rushed into the hospital and said, doctor, doctor, there is a bird outside. And the doctor said, why are you afraid of the bird? Don't you know that you are a human being, you are not a worm? Then he said, doctor, I know I am a human being. But you have not treated the bird. Does the bird know I am a human being? Nah. That is problem. My conviction is independent of others agreeing with me or not agreeing with me. It is others' problem. And therefore, until that conviction comes, let the whole world say, I am a mortal creature. I know that maye vasakalam jatam, maji sarvam pratishthitam, maji sarvam layam yati, tad brahmadvayam asmyaham. I am that Brahman from which the whole world arises, in whom the whole world rests, and unto whom the whole world resolves, that Brahman I am. This is called self-knowledge. So, and how do you get it? Shravanam and mananam. What do you get? Dridha jnanam. Nissamshaya jnanam. And people ask, isn't it intellectual knowledge? We will say it is intellectual knowledge, and every knowledge is intellectual. As Dayananda Swamiji beautifully says, there is no nasal knowledge. Knowledge is always in the intellect alone. So now, we go through preparatory meditation in the beginning, which is called what? Upasana dhyanam. Thereafterwards, one has to switch over to shravanam and mananam. Through shravanam and mananam, we will get clear knowledge. And this clear knowledge is capable of giving liberation. This clear knowledge is capable of giving liberation, which is a total transformation of my life. So, this knowledge is capable of giving liberation or jivan mukti, which is a total transformation of life. And what do you mean by liberation? It was explained in the second chapter, third, fourth, etc., freedom from raga, dvesha, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya. Freedom from all internal problems, irrespective of external situations. The mind is free from problems, and this transformation can be called jivan muktihi, or it can be called saintliness. A person becomes a saint, sainthood. And how can you define saintliness in simple word? Saintliness can be defined in several ways. Gita is full of such definition, but I will put in the simplest form. A saintly person is one who is incapable of getting hurt by external situation, and who is incapable of hurting other people. Neither he is hurt or disturbed by the ups and downs of the creation or the life, and nor he hurts or disturbs anyone. Krishna tells in the 12th chapter, yasmanna udvijate lokaha lokanna udvijate chayaha. He doesn't hurt others and he is not hurt by others. You can call it shanti, you can call it samatvam, you can call it compassion, you can call it love, any number of words you can give. This jivan mukti is the benefit of this knowledge. But here there is a problem. This knowledge has to be converted into, has to produce the result of jivan mukti. But often we find that even when this knowledge is there, we are not free from mental problem. In the normal course, this conviction should give me liberation. But often we find that in spite of the conviction, my mind does not